Hey, welcome back to session 14 at CE 120C 220C. Today we're gonna continue talking about evaluation and some of the different things we've been running into as people have been working on their assignments, trying to see if we can debug some of the different things or actually help solve some of the problems people are kind of encountering, as well as just kind of continuing to talk about overall the approach towards evaluation strategies. What are we trying to accomplish with these list maps and all these evaluators in terms of trying to find something that we consider to be a better design? Yeah, it's hard to say that ever you have a truly optimal design, because what optimum is really depends on what you're trying to maximize. And it could be whether you're trying to get shade or whether you're trying to actually get sun, since you're trying to collect it for solar energy or minimize the cost, or there's all these different evaluation criteria that might be using. But even for the purpose of your assignment, sort of what you choose to maximize is up to you. It's just the really kind of important thing is that ultimately you just have to have a rationale for what you're after and approach that sort of makes sense for delivering that. Okay, but yeah, what you're specifically going after is somewhat variable. We'll answer some questions about that as we get going today. In terms of where we were last time, we pretty much looked at list maps to go through and do what I'll call an exhaustive type of evaluation. And that's what we're going to start getting into today, is thinking about there really being different strategies. We've been working on the whole notion of creating different evaluators, different things that can somehow rank, or not really rank, just sort of come up with ratings of different design solutions that we then decide that we're going to go through and rank to try and come up with something that we think is the preferred solution. But as we go through and look at a lot of different solutions, okay, there certainly gets to be this big issue of really how do we march around through that search space. Okay, and what we've been doing is using something called the list map function. The list map function is very much like a for loop. It is exhaustive in the sense that you tell it where to start, you tell it where to end, and you pretty much give it an increment to go marching along, and it'll go searching in all those different points. Okay, now, it'll do what you tell it from start to end, exhaustively, I call it that, in that it doesn't really kind of understand or keep track of where it is at any particular point. It just is going to say, if you go through 1 through 100, it will go all the way through 1 through 100. Okay. But if you can start thinking about a search space that might have multiple variables and actually have many different values to consider, you might imagine that the total number of values you might want to search could start to get to be very, very large if you'd have to do it exhaustively. If, for example, I had 10 degrees of rotation that I were going to try and 10 different heights I was going to try, all of a sudden I would have 100 different points that I'd have to go through and compute. And if I was doing something like the solar analysis, that could take an awfully long time. Okay. It gets even worse if you start imagining more variables that you want to put in there, you start cubing it, you start having thousands of things that you have to consider. So list mapping, it turns out, is sort of a pretty good strategy for guaranteeing that you're going to consider every point. But we're going to figure out that it's actually not a great strategy in terms of efficiency, because it's not very smart about what it's doing. It's just doing everything. It's looking under every rock. So we're going to start moving ourselves into thinking about control strategies and really how we can move beyond list mapping to doing things that either kind of check the values as it goes and says, hey, is this sufficient or is this not sufficient? That's going to be called a while loop, where we'll keep on iterating as long as a certain condition is met, but as soon as that condition is not met, or as soon as a condition is achieved, either way you can want to look at it, you'll then go ahead and stop, because you're sufficient. You sort of hit that level. So that's a good strategy. A third control strategy we're going to look at, though, we'll get into this next time more, is we're going to start looking at more of what are called genetic strategies. Okay, where what we do is, as opposed to exhaustively going over the entire space, we go through, and you can almost think about just castings, like different test cases into the wind, and they're going to fall wherever they might on the field. Okay, and which point we're going to go ahead and ask each of the different test cases, how did you do? How did you do? How did you do? And out of those results, we'll say, ooh, okay, Andrew seems like he got a pretty good result. Okay, everyone, let's come on down to Andrew's end of the field, and we'll recast it and can look very locally around where he was. There might be two places that look pretty interesting, but what we're going to keep on doing is you know, at every iteration, going to the places that look more interesting and then biasing our continued sampling in those locations. Okay, so yeah, genetic, because it's kind of like dominant genes and kind of, yeah. So cool strategies, but we're getting to that. Okay, where we left off last time was we looked at a couple of list maps. We flexed a simple box to go ahead and kind of make a look at things. We also flexed our twisting towers. In our twisting tower, as we went through and twisted our tower, the ever so interesting question that came from that end of the room was, could you go ahead and look at this in terms of pairs? And we fumbled around with that. And thanks to the combined brain power of everything going on in the studio here, we found answers to some of the problems we had. So let me just go ahead and share those with you, because they're kind of important in terms of knowing how to do some of these things. And I'll thank Jacqueline and Andrew for coming up with two different parts of the solution. Okay, in terms of the example, so we're going to start with basically using the list map to flex the tower. We're going to use the pairs, and not that example again, we're going to revisit it in terms of how to fix that. Then we're going to go through and, again, do one last list map thing where we're going to vary the overall info parameters. I think just a few of you sort of got into doing this where we tried to take everything about your entire system and put it in a giant custom node and vary that to come up with a single value. Okay, we'll look at what I sort of have in mind there in terms of trying to come up with an overall optimum by flexing the value. Okay, so we'll do that with those sine waves. Then I'm going to show a couple sort of interesting examples that have come out of sort of work people have been doing lately. This is a really cool example about sort of doing parametric facade design using some adaptive components of a tree structure. Someone who's actually working for the global AEC class is working on right now, so I wanted to share that with you because it's kind of a cool kind of mathematical pattern. As well as start to look at evaluating, and even evaluating just sort of simple panels and stuff like that, how we can actually start evaluating rooms and things that are sort of more meaningful objects to say, hey, okay, based on the size of this room, do I need one or two doors? Do I have enough windows? There's all these different things we could do to look at and evaluate your designs to make sure they're good. So kind of thinking like a little code-checking design advisor, okay, drawing your attention to things. Okay, but let's start with twisting that tower and looking at the issue of pairs. If you can, please go over to example 14.1, and we will see what we can figure out. Okay, where is, there it is. Let me go ahead and I will just switch that back out of full screen. Tiny window over there. That doesn't look very good. Okay, you. Come with me. Okay. And if you open up the example 14.1, you will find the ever-popular twisting tower. But we'll go ahead and look at it a little bit differently. So I'm going to close this one up. That's for a little bit later. Instead, I'm going to open up 14.1. So here we have our little twisting tower. We were trying to do last time, we looked at sort of the whole issue of we flex the height and go through and compute. As we did go through and flex the height, could we go through and grab things like its gross surface area, its gross volume? We can even look at the whole issue of gross floor area if you want to. But you're trying to sort of go through and just flex it a little bit. The whole issue of gross floor area, let me go and address it again just ever so briefly here. If we do want to have gross floor area available to us, what we have to do is basically just turn on mass floors. Okay? Because the mass doesn't currently have floor area, but if we choose the mass and we say let's turn on the floors, we get a little floor area. Now, you will note that I only have two floors right now because that's all I really had defined in my Revit object right now. So, but I do have a little bit of floor area for that. If you want to look at floor area for a big old tower like this, let me just kind of like show you that what you have to do is, if you want to have a lot of different potential floors and be able to consider them, is just set up levels for all those floors and say that you want to turn on the levels for the mass. Even if the mass isn't that tall, if the mass grows to be that tall, at the point that it intersects with the floor level, it'll then pick up that floor. Okay? So you can do a little stuff in advance, and let me just kind of show you what I have in mind to do that. For example, if I go to the south elevation, you'll see I only have those two so far. That's not going to do us very good. If I want this thing to be 40 or 50 stories tall, I need a whole lot more levels, so let's talk about that. I could go through and do this. When I'm adding levels, a lot of people watch me go to the level tool under the architecture tab, kind of pick a line, and then put an offset in. And that's actually not a bad way. Sure beats drawing them all one at a time. So I can say, great, that's going to be, if I hover just above level 3, that's going to be level 4. And that's going to be okay, but you know, somewhere along the way I'm going to get bored of doing that. I'm going to have to put 100 of them in there. So let me kind of show you another technique, because all your good kind of just CAD techniques are good. Oh, if for example I say that I want to array, what I can do is choose that object. Actually, I think I have to array it now. Okay. What I'm going to do is say just how many different elements I want to put in there. And then I can say whether I'm going to go to the second or the last. If I'm going to do a 10-foot floor height, I'm just going to go to the second one. I'm going to go from 3 up to 4 by 10 feet. Say, give me 100 of them, and I'll get a bunch of them. So to do that, I'll say, great, it's going to be 100 of them. I'll go here. I'll come up 10 feet. Now I got them all. So quickie ways, if you ever find yourself working out of a gigantic tower structure. The nice thing about even doing it this way is if later on I decide that my floor height is 15 or something like that, if I change one of the very different distances, it will change it for all 100 of them.
How did you get the number?
Okay, for in the array.
Oh, it's an array. Okay,
so go ahead and choose the array. Yeah. Exactly. So with my guys all arrayed here, I can come on back. I can come over here, and when I say mass floors, I have a huge old list there of all the different floors. Again, I may not be exploiting all the floors just yet, but if I turn them all on, if it actually happens to grow to be so tall that it intersects with those floor levels, you'll get them. So I'm just going to go through and from the beginning to the end, just do a shift click to get them all. Actually, I have to get the, what do I have to do? Then I have to click the little checkbox. I get a whole bunch of floors in there. And that might be a fairer way to look at this tower in terms of evaluating it. You can start to see that based on this interesting curvaceous shape, I have a lot of floor area on the lower floor. They get really skinny in the middle, and I kind of get taller at the top. Oh, what you got to do is you come on in, and you say mass floors, and what I usually do is I end up sort of selecting the whole bunch, and then you have to come over here and hit the checkbox.
Okay.
So super. You have a really quick evaluator now that says if you're going to have, something which is, 600 feet tall, which is going to be around 60 stories, given the 10-foot floor height, it's going to have a gross floor area around 250,000. If I went through and made that, 700 feet tall, you'll see it'll grow, and it'll grow to be 304,000. So at a high level, what we're playing around with this whole example, just kind of putting it in context, is really, if you've been given an urban site, you have a certain sort of design requirement for how much space you need to accomplish to put on that site. A lot of times, long before people start getting into very detailed design, they'll just play with a form and sort of figure out, okay, what is the trade-off between the height, the amount of taper, the amount of twist, really, how much do I, you know, what can I do? They're just trying to understand the form and evaluate it in terms of different potential shapes that might be on that site that will meet the design requirements, and then to evaluate them to say, oh, okay, this one has really good view potential, or this one's gonna have a really good wind shedding potential, or something like that. So at a high level, that's all we're really up to, is really evaluating different forms. And I keep on using this very simple evaluation of just pulling out like the floor area or the surface area. You can do things that are much more interesting and complex, but it's all about just sort of varying forms before you get to the detailed design. Okay, so that's just to get us going, but let's go ahead and take a look at the dynamo now. What we can do is, in terms of varying that form, go over. I will open up in session 14.1. We're gonna go ahead and skip past the early ones in here, because what we're gonna do is actually go right to 3A. We looked at, for a single input output and multiple outputs, how to do that. It all starts getting interesting down here in 3A in terms of understanding the pairing of the outputs. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. If you open up 3A, and let me sort of expand this a little bit on my screen. We'll take a look at where we were last time and where we needed to kind of like change it. Okay. Where we were last time was we took this beautiful element, we gave it some sort of test parameter, whether it was rotation or whether it was the top height. We fed it a range of values. In this case, I'm going to from 300 to 600 by 100, so 300, 400, 500. On the other rotation side, I'm going from 15 to 90, just rotating that 15 at a time. Okay. It's null right now because I haven't run it just yet. But what we were doing is testing a single value, and we did a list map. In this case, if I have it mid list mapped to do the top rotations, it'll evaluate 15, 30, 45, 60, and so on. And then because I'm pulling results list as the result, or as what I'm feeding in as the function for this map, it'll give me back those pairs. It'll give me the pair of the rotation and whatever the evaluation was. Okay, that was all pretty good in terms of getting going. But when we tried to go through and say, well, of course you ought to be able to extend this to do a pair, we sort of ran into a couple different issues. And Jacqueline and Andrew sort of gave us solutions to each of the different problems we ran into. One of the problems we ran into was we have these two different sequences. We have a sequence that has the height sequence. We have a sequence which has the rotation sequence. The question is, could we actually create pairs of all those different things and kind of come up with an exhaustive little matrix that has all those different values? And Ms. Jacqueline found for us the list Cartesian product. Who knew? Okay, what Cartesian product does is it takes everything in that first list. In our case, we're joining the list, which sort of appends two things together, and it's gonna just put them all together pairwise. Okay, so if we go through and run my little Cartesian product, let me go ahead, I'll just gonna run this. Some other things will fail right now, but that's okay. Because I'm let that run in the background. I just want to see what the results of all this are. In fact, I should comment, what I probably should do is disconnect the part that's doing the evaluation on a single variable, because I really just need this answer. You know, I don't need to have that run every time in the background. I was talking to some people as we were working in office hours about just disconnecting things. If you already have all the panels generated, you're just working on the evaluation, just connect the part that's regenerating the panels, because it will just save you the time. It will still work with the existing panels. Okay, so the Cartesian product looks something like this. Check it out. Looking not too awfully bad. So I have 300 with each of the different values. I have 400 with each of the different values. I have 600 with each of the different values. So that's pretty good. It's going through and making that little matrix for us that gathers both of them. So, very, very nice. Now, in terms of working with this, there's just one other thing I've got to do, though, because as I feed these over into a function as a series of pairs, you'll see I not only have the pairs, but each of the rows is still there. So I have like two levels of hierarchy right now. I have the individual pairs, but then I have them grouped by the first values. So what I need to do is if I'm going to go through and send them on over my input values that I'm going to specify as a list, I just need to flatten out the list by one. Okay? That will remove the row wise. Every pair will be considered equal. So watch out for that. So what I'm going to do is take my beautiful list. I'm going to flatten it. In fact, what I'm going to do just to sort of make it easier up here, let me just take out the list map over there. That way I won't do that anymore. Okay, let's flatten this and run this again. You should now have a nice flat list. Don't worry about the warnings right now. That's because I have some unhooked nodes kind of hanging on different places. And that's really what I want. So this was the first half of the whole equation. Could we go through and just generate these? If I do have these, I got a fantastic looking list of pairs. What I need to do is just go ahead and take that list and put it into the list map. Okay, so it'll be the list that's evaluated. Each and every one of them, because it'll do from start to finish. Okay. The second question that came up was, when we went through and we created our function to do the evaluation, and I plugged in these pairs of points as the input value, it didn't interpret it right. It sort of had this problem where it didn't sort of get it as a pair. It sort of looked like it got it as a pair, but then when we tried to go through and take out item one versus item two, item one came out, well, let's even sort of try it. Let's see if we can like see what it looks like. It's, if I take it back over to the original, which is right there, I'm gonna plug this hole. The reason I have this little thing hanging around called plug is I created a function that has two variations on the input value and how to bring it in there. Okay. Plug is basically just plug and hole, so that we are, you know, since input functions can only have, or functions can only have the one input, I have to plug the hole. Okay, let me go ahead and put the test value parameter names in there too, just as we'll need that to evaluate. The first test parameter is gonna be height. Second one, I believe, is rotation. Okay, so now I got a beautiful looking function in here. The way this is kind of currently set up right now, my function is not quite right. What I need to have is sort of one thing empty and one thing full. So what I'm going to do is, I'm not going to take this flat list and put it in the input value list. What I actually need to do is put that over in the list map. I sort of made a mistake there a moment ago. Take that and leave it open. Okay. So let's just talk about the difference between those two different things. If you take the values and you plug it in directly, okay, what will typically happen is you'll either get an error from the node, or it would only evaluate one of them. It won't evaluate each and every one. The only way to get it to evaluate each and every one individually is to go ahead and do the list map and then leave the whole. And then it'll sort of say, oh, okay, you're giving me a list. Let me grab the first item of the list, the second item of the list, the third item of the list. Okay, so but every once in a while when we're testing, I'll go through and say, well, let's just evaluate it and see if it works for one, and I'll plug it in directly. Okay, which really just has the effect of, you know, doing one. Actually, an even better way, if you want to do that and you want to do that little bit of testing, is do this. You say, I've done this with a lot of you, we'll say get item at index. Actually, I'll put the zero with item after the first item. Okay. That would work, because what I'm doing is I'm just grabbing the first item of the list and plugging it in there. So those should work, either one of those should work, either grabbing the first item and plugging it in directly, or list mapping to test it all. But every once in a while, for the purposes of testing, I'll do that, just to kind of see, you know, before we try to do it for 100, can we get it to work just for one? Now, Andrew pointed out to me A very nice way of doing it with a code block, which works out very well. I always kind of stumble with this because I always try to put parentheses in here and it doesn't work. But I'm just going to just put a list of items and it's the brackets. So somehow, list of items, item zero, is actually just a shorthand way of doing that. So again, depending if you like to type your program in or if you like to throw nodes in there, this is a nice way of using the code block to make that a little simpler. So let's just get the first item out of the list. So list of items, so I'm taking the list, and I'm getting the zeroth item, is the same as get item at index zero. Shortcut.
Yeah.
Cool. Take advantage of those things. So that would work too. So I could evaluate it for a single item, or I can get the whole list of items. Either way, single items, and I'll disconnect the list map. If I go through and leave the whole, then I plug in the list instead. I'll leave the whole, and I'll plug in the list instead. So we're almost in good shape. But let's take a look at what happens inside here. Oops, now what I want to do is, oh, let me do it this way. I'll do it the kind of first one, the way that I know is going to fail. Let's go ahead and open this node up and take a look at what the difference is. Back over here, there are just two different ways that we might go through and specify what's happening. Yeah, input value list, which came up with var, that was the default way that it came in. When I first created my custom node, it did that. And the problem with that is it sort of failed. It didn't sort of give us the right answer. What we're going to look at is another way of doing it where we do something called casting the results. So we have something we're bringing in here. We're going to give it a little bit of a clue about what is it that you're taking? How should you treat this thing? Just in case it's a little confused. Var is kind of perfectly generic. Var, where we have the brackets here, is basically telling you that you have, do they call it a list? Or
some
they
sort
call
of array.
Some sort of an array.
List of lists. Go down more levels.
Okay. It's some sort of an array structure. Okay. And that little bit was all it took to actually get this example to work right. So if we leave it as var, it gets a little bit confused. If we actually give it a little notation that tells it you're actually feeding it a list, it does a little bit better in terms of understanding it. So the result of all this was, let me go ahead and just kind of run it the first way. Where we were last time was we took this list and I got the first item. Actually, I could even just do it down here. Okay, we'll just watch those results and then we'll go ahead and do it again. So what I'm doing is I'm just trying it the original broken way, the way that doesn't interpret it quite properly. What I'll do is go back over and run it. That's okay. Oh, you remember it said it couldn't make some of these different types. I remember that error from last time because it was basically putting things in like upside down. It wasn't interpreting things right.
I think you have to press delete.
You have to do what? Oh, delete will actually knock it out. You're correct, that'll actually work. I think what it's trying is for all 24 values. I'll just delete it. Okay. But if we go back in here and we take a look at what's going on, the problem is when it's trying to interpret this list, it's kind of getting some value, but it's not getting both values. It's sort of just getting a chunk of it. It's not sure what to do. In this case, it's getting one of the values, so I get the first and the last. It just gets sort of confused about what's going on because it's looking for list item zero, and it thinks it's a number. It's just somehow confused about what's going on. So to fix this, what we're going to do is actually just go back and use the part that understands it's a list. Then we'll go through and take care and do what we want. So what I'll do is I'll take, as opposed to that single value, which isn't reading it correctly, I'll feed it the list. Let me go ahead and pull that up into there too. Now, again, these two things will be equivalent. I can say this get item at 0 and it'll give us a number. This get item at 1 will give us a number. This is going to be the same basic result. So if you pull from here, I can pull whatever. It should just be the same thing. Okay. What I'm going to do over here, though, is switch around the function a little bit. So back over here, as opposed to plugging that one, I'm going to plug this one. I'm going to leave this one open instead. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is plug in my fabulous Cartesian product list. It's going to fill it in. It's going to cast it as a list. And hopefully it's going to give us some good results. Okay, let's check it out and see how it does. Just because, oops, I like to see this. Well, since I deleted it, I may be in trouble. Let me come back over here. I probably have to place the other one. Twisting, where's my triangular mass? There it is. I got one hanging around. That's not looking too awfully bad. Let me just pan that down so you can sort of see it a little bit better as we work. Now, I think I probably also have to go back in my Dynamo and reselect it just because it's actually a new instance now. So you see that the element's not selected because I deleted the old one. Select. Okay, now we're selected. Okay, I think we are ready to run, and we should be able to sort of basically have these pairs evaluated, kind of the different height as well as the different rotations. Let's check it out. I'll give it a run. Let's see what it's doing. You can sort of see the first height checking the different rotations, the second height checking the rotations, the third height checking the rotations, the fourth height checking the rotations. Excellent. So at the tail end of all this, the result of the list map now is basically a whole series of different kind of height and like a rotation outputs, or those are the inputs, as well as the results that we're reporting for each of those comparisons. It's not too awfully bad. Okay. It sort of does what we want it to do. Okay. Let me pause there for a second, just in terms of what that's up to. And yes, Clark.
What if you wanted it to check all the heights and all the rotations with each other?
In what sense? What do you want to do?
As in not having them paired together, but having them do the cross product, right?
Actually, by doing the Cartesian product, we did sort of end up getting all the pairs.
But they're the same
number of values
as your listing, right? So instead of, are there 25 each? Oh, you're right.
Yeah, it kind of, it did that as opposed to.
I thought we were getting like 25 points.
Yeah, so we gave it like 4 and 6.
Cool.
And then it did the cross product. So it did it exhaustively. As opposed to doing a single string, we could have added a single string of like, you know, values. So this sort of a Cartesian product. Wonderful tool. Who knew? Get you all those. Now, this is actually looking pretty good. Let me just like comment a little tail end thing here. You'll see I have something that looks kind of like a grid. It's a little warped though, in terms of if I wanted to go through and write this out to Excel right now and kind of just have a nice table where I can see all the different height values and rotation values, it won't quite write out right now because there's a bump in the hierarchy. So the data, yeah. So if I try to write that out, it won't write a nice grid. If we want to write it out to Excel, all I would have to do is, let's go back into my function. And the problem really is, it's right over here. We're down at the bottom. We are creating a list of the two different result values. Actually, if I wanted to get the gross floor area, I could get that now too, since I computed that now. I could add that in. I like to go off script. So I'll get the gross floor area. Okay, let's go ahead and add that in as another variable we can grab. Might as well, as long as we're in here. If I want to sort of have those input values not come as a pair, but I want to have them come as two separate values, so we'll write out as separate data columns, what I got to do is as follows. Just add another index to this. I'm just going to push all these down. And then for the first and second values, not feed it the pair, but actually feed it the individual values. So what I'll do is for the index 0, I'll feed it the height values. And for index 1, I'll feed it the rotation values. That, now I just have rows by 5 columns. That will now flatten it out. Let me pause there for a second, see if that kind of made sense. Doing good? How about up front here? How are you guys feeling? They kind of okay? Okay, we're just gonna go through and keep on playing games like this where we're gonna keep on changing input values, do some sort of evaluation. Here I'm just gonna do this really simple, just grab the values. But the idea is always I want to see input values, I want to see evaluations, and have pairs of them so that I can like just sort of see how good each of those different solutions is. Okay, so if I run that and I come back over here, let's see if I run this over here again. It'll go back through, do what it needs to. Now the problem we sort of run into a lot when we're doing things like this is every once in a while, somewhere in the custom node, what happens is just things get out of the right hierarchy, so there's something that's just hard to figure out why it's not able to generate them. That's interesting on my gross floor areas showing a value of 0. I must have the wrong name or something like that for what's going on. Let's check that out. It says gross floor area. Oh, you know what it was? On this one, I didn't put the mass floors back in because I deleted the other element. Okay. There's always something. And now it has some gross floor area. Okay, but the hardest part of this usually just is that sometimes inside the custom node, something happens that's a little bit like the black box and you're not quite sure what it is. And then we have to use some watch nodes to sort of figure out what's going on. So what's going on in there is over inside the custom node, since I can't just sort of preview what the results are, I often end up leaving myself, just these little bits of like watch hanging around. And that actually works out pretty well in terms of being able to see things. But you don't get to see each and every value. You only get to see the last value, which is kind of annoying in terms of what you need to do. Now, a solution to this, let me just kind of give you one other kind of funky variation on this, because I think Claire and I are going to have to use it to kind of sort out something within hers. If every once in a while these watches, even they don't show you values. You get this little bluish green kind of square, and it's incredibly frustrating because you can't tell what it means. It just sort of, it's the intermediate result. And it tends to happen when nodes get very big and complex. And, you know, there's no easy way to fix it. Often, it's not that your logic's wrong, it's just that the watch isn't showing you anything useful. So a way of combating that is we can watch, that's actually okay, but another way of sort of dealing with this is any value along the way you can just set up as an output. Okay, and the nice thing about as an output is when you list map, it'll show you what the value was for each of the different items as it evaluated it. So for example, if, for whatever reason, this just wasn't showing up, it was showing up as a blue box, and I actually wanted to sort of see what it was from the outside, what I can do is this. I can say, let's go ahead and put an output in here. And I'll say, show me the rotation value, or it's the height value, for each. Okay. That now has an output on the function. So if as I'm testing, I want to sort of see what those are, what I can do is actually just map that in as the function result that I want to see instead. So if I did that, it's going to go through and show me just the rotation values, or the height, or yeah, the height value for each iteration. So you can always go through and do that. That's sometimes a way of, again, just doing some debugging. It's running right now. I think things flopping around in the background over there. Hopefully this time, you know, this watch will look a little bit different because it's only going to show me the height values this time. It's not going to show me the result list. Actually, you'll see it popping around over there. It seems that if it doesn't sort of interpret it properly, that helps it. So I put it in the category of no harm in doing it. So if you believe in the whole belt and suspenders thing, it seems to just sort of give you a little more certainty about how it's going to interpret the result. Okay, this time it's taking a little bit longer because it's actually, it's doing the calculation for the floor area for each of the different iterations too. But I think this will even start to demonstrate where, you know, as we're starting to do a slightly more complicated evaluation, where doing a list map may not be the best way to do this, because it's sort of doing things exhaustively just takes a lot of time. Okay, I want to let that finish running. I just want to talk about how if you prefer to see these results as Excel file, you can. As we were working, Clara commented, oh, this would be so much better if I just get into an Excel file and draw some graphs or just do something like that. So the way you do that, if it ever stops running, is we're going to just take the list, this list which is over here. There's a node that's kind of currently up the top of my screen. I'll show you this. It says, the thing that says Excel write to file. So you can pan on up there and take a look on your screen and see it. All you're really going to do is feed in this matrix as the data result to write out. And then we'll write it as a nice, good looking Excel file for you. Just taking too long. Okay, let me pause it as it's doing its thing there. Just answer questions. So, yes, Ms. Jacqueline, what do you have? Just that in the Excel, I'll show you the parameters. You know, we can say whether to overwrite. We can also sort of, we can somehow change one of the parameters there is sheet names. So if, for example, you wanted to put different results in different sheets on different tabs of the Excel file, just go ahead and have different parameters to fill in there. So, okay, let's look at that. Here's my height value. It's pretty boring in terms of what's going on, but. That was that. Let me go ahead and I'll pull the result list back because I'm sort of more interested in that. But what happens is when you write the Excel file, so I'm going to get my fabulous result list and bring it in as my data. Okay, one question is the whole issue of overwrite. Typically it is false. That's interesting. I guess I think if the file already exists, if you keep it in the same file name, that's interesting because it seems like it's overwriting for me. Maybe it's going to ask if it exists. So this part right here, it says my results sheet. If you change that, then you get another tab.
And since it's going through the
loop
itself,
yeah.
So it can't terminate it and change it every time.
Say again.
Can you try and run it? I don't know if
it's sure. No worries. Okay, so I'm going to go over to Excel. And let us do this. Actually, just to make it a little quicker for us, I'm going to edit the custom node. I'm just going to take out that part that does the values. Well, actually, that's not going to make a whole lot of difference because it's going to compute them anyway. Okay, let's come back over here. I'll do this. I'll go on out to my desktop. Let's say session 14 Excel data. .xls. Okay, that should work there. I got that. I'm going to run that to make it a little simpler. Let me do this. I'm just going to go from 15 to 30. And over here, I'll go just to, I'm just going to make the data set shorter so that it computes a little quicker. Okay, that should be short. Let's go ahead and run this. So that's running. What is the symptom you see on yours? You see it, does it say, what about overwriting? You just put the data on top of the old data, or what do you see?
It's like you have different pairs.
Yes. Because it shouldn't be doing that. It should just wait to see the whole grid at the same time. Does your data grid at the bottom look like, are all the pairs showing up in the data grid?
It showed up in the watch, but it didn't show up in Excel.
Really? That's kind of interesting. I'm going to let that keep on running for a second. And as it does, let me see if we can take a look at that. I know it. That is kind of mysterious. Okay. So you only get one value, but it shows up in the data grid. In your data grid, see how you have the funny pair? You have the indented pair. So what's happening is, since the not understood is really rows and columns, the first one over there, the 30 and 15, since it's indented to level, is confused and it doesn't know how to write it to itself. So what you gotta do is back over in there, break it so those come as those two different input values on separate lines at the same level hierarchy. Remember, So the reason is the hierarchy is wrong. Yeah. So if you go back into the node and reset the hierarchy, so that as opposed to a pair, that it actually feeds the two different values in. Okay. Let me show you what Jacqueline is asking about. The question is, or the problem is, kind of both. What's happening for Jacqueline is, when it writes the Excel file, it seems to be putting it in the wrong spot. And that's not good. The reason is, if this is not flat, if it's for each of the different rows, it doesn't have the values all at the same level, it gets confused about how to write the Excel file. So the solution is, you have to make sure in the custom node to come back over here and do that part where, as we're writing it out, we don't write out the pairs, but we write out each of the individual values. Okay, and that should clear that up for you. But let's just kind of like, pause to refresh for a minute and sort of see how that feels. Okay, does, for the most part, this idea of like using the list map and going through creating these like grids of values and writing out to Excel, let's just get a reality check on how that feels to you. That kind of, okay? Beautiful. Okay then, let us go ahead and we'll kind of keep on plugging away. This whole thing that we've been doing here in terms of evaluating these different values, changing the form around, and like just kind of reporting these simple values, you know, it works well enough in terms of returning something like this. You can use the same sort of operation though to go through and either use the solar analysis tool to kind of look at a surface, or you can go ahead and really, either by you looking at the directness values or the solar values on each of the panels, any of those things, just for any form, the same way that you were able to kind of evaluate that form, and then I asked you to change the input sliders and see if you could find a better form, or what you thought was a good form. Okay. You know, we can automate that and put that in a list map and kind of create high-level nodes. And that's really where you want to go to ultimately with this, is you want to be able to create these high-level nodes that often contain smaller nodes. Let's go ahead and take a look at what that might look like. So we're going to look at, oh, it's example 14.2. And in 14.2, what we're going to look at, let me go ahead and I'll cancel that. Just look at that whole solar analysis one again. Okay, so this is that old panelized surface. In fact, even for that, let me get rid of those because I don't really care about seeing the panels. Although you can sort of see, this is where a lot of us sort of ended up at the end of even assignment two. Some of you sort of here. You have basically a wavy surface or some sort of surface is panelized. And the question is really how we evaluated that. You could be showing the colors based on the directness values, or you could be showing the colors based on the insulation values.
Yeah.
Same basic operation, just two different things. The insulation values takes longer to compute, but it's probably a better metric, just because it takes into account the broader range of times of year and different times of the day. In order to sort of evaluate this, though, let's go ahead and go to Dynamo. And we will open up into 14.2. If I get out to 14.2. Let's start with 1A. You might remember, is it's kind of the beginning of the function. That's the function where we created these different little sine waves. Based on that, we lopped a surface, and then based on that surface, we came on down here to this little solar evaluator function, and we used the solar evaluator function. Yeah, for better or for worse, there's different things. I'm going to change that over to manual just because it's kind of slow to run it all the time. But we have this solar radiation function, and that ultimately produces some values, and we map the values, and that's kind of the high level thing that was going on here. The question was, could we do this? Could we go ahead and encapsulate this so that we give ourselves the ability to both generate the geometry, and then four different geometries, go through and do the solar radiation analysis and put those together into a custom node. And that was the first step of this whole operation, was going through and at some level, just grabbing all this stuff and just grabbing all that stuff and putting it together into a custom node. Okay. And when you do that, what ends up happening is the things that are the outliers, the things that are hanging outside, become either inputs or outputs to it. And this is where both either wonderful things happen or your life is really scary. Because when you put it all into a custom node, some things work very well, other things don't work nearly as well. But for the most part, it's the way we have to approach this. So to do that, I could come through and say, let's grab this, I'm gonna grab this one, I'm gonna grab that one. The nice thing about groups is that actually makes it pretty easy. So I'm gonna grab all those guys together. I'm gonna leave this whole question about the graphing out right now because I can only really, or I probably wanna graph the final one. I don't wanna graph it every time. But what I typically do is I'll come through and say, let's go through and create a node from the selection. And I'll give it, session 14 solar example. CE120, and I'll make a node out of that. And what it did was, it's actually pretty good. It goes through and created a single node that just has a few inputs. It has the length of the surface, it has the weather, it has the time study, and it's gonna return some values. So, okay, what you do is, let me pop back out again. You choose them, let me see if I can grab these guys too. It was easier when they were all there. I grab all those input values and I say, let's create a node from the selection. Okay, and it's really just encapsulating them all. But let me do this. I want to go to the one that actually has it encapsulated, because the B I actually sort of puts a little bit more into. So if you can, open up the 1B instead. That's just how we got to here. Again, as soon as you can, like, change it to manual, because I've forgotten to save it to manual. It just, okay. And I'm gonna change that to manual also, just so it doesn't automatically. Stop! Too late. Is you can sort of see in the middle of this, there's this one thing called the evaluation function. What is that? It's all that geometry and all that analysis stuff sort of encapsulated just in a single evaluation function. Great. Now I'm going to say manual to it, but let's take a look at this. Because we've been playing around with the solar function, there's a couple of sort of interesting gotchas to the whole thing. In this one, I have this evaluation function. That's kind of okay. It wants a weather, it wants a time city. I decided to leave the length of the surface out, as well as the degree of project rotation. Leave those out as things that I could change. So I could try rotating it 10, 20, 30 degrees and sort of see if I can do better on the value. I could also change the length. But inside this function is the ability both to go through and generate the curves, create the surface, and then evaluate the surface. So if you go digging around inside that function, it's not too awfully bad. Let's just take a look in there. It kind of looks familiar. We have sort of this whole issue of length of surface. Now, this is a little bit funny, because even the length over here, it has that sort of notation where it looks like it could take a list. And I don't actually think that's correct. It should actually be, so if you want to fix that, I think you probably can. I just really want that to be like var. Okay. Let's do a little rethinking. Okay. It goes through, it creates the surface, it creates the lofted surface based on that. Super. Down here, as we get down further, that all looks familiar. It's just going to take in a weather, a time study, and a degree of project rotation, and it just plugs them in as values to here. So this is actually, oops, still not there. Oh, it's well played too. There we go. So down here, this is all pretty familiar. In terms of what we choose to output, and this is always our choice, we can kind of take out the cumulative values, we can take out the points, we can take out the average. What I did inside this function is I took all those different values, I flattened the list of the cumulative values, and I computed an average. So all I really have is like average insulation. So it's actually a really property, average cumulative insulation. And at the end, the results list, that's just going to pair up project rotations with the average. You will see how the two kind of side by side. Okay, so that's my function. It's not too awfully bad. It's doing a little rework on my side because I changed something about the outputs. Come back over here. Okay, so I got my custom node. That's kind of looking pretty good. We are ready to start using this. Now, in terms of using it and just really testing whether our node works or not, if I don't use a list map again, if I just go through and feed in a single value for the project rotation, it should still give me a good result. Okay, and that's what we're testing first. So even here, I've got a value of 0 for the rotation. I'm hoping I'm getting some sort of average cumulative insulation out here. If I go through and run it, I should get a result. just playing around down here. In fact, let me just go ahead and run that. Actually, still automatic, that's why. Okay, I'll run it. It'll be doing its thing in the background. In terms of the time study, Andrew and I were doing some playing around with the time study and found some interesting aspects of the time study. And we're not 100% locked into how this all works, but let's see if I can run completed. Let's see if I can expose some things here. You see, I am getting a value over here. It's 525,000, more or less. Okay. The time study, though, sometimes give us some interesting problems. If you are getting a bunch of zero values, chances are there's something about your time study that's a little bit off. So let's talk about how it may be off. Yeah. It seems to somehow get confused when you just give it a start and date time. If you end up having hours, basically, if you do 6 a.m. to 6 a.m., or like 12 a.m. to 12 a.m., sometimes it interprets that as zero, like you got no sun. So there's something where it seems to get confused sometimes, where it's like, you know, it's not evaluating any hours at all. Okay, if you're getting zeros, don't assume it's you. Assume that there's something about the time study that's a little bit off in terms of what's going on. But we tried some different variations, and Andrew tried some different variations too. I said, let's take some explicit times and say, do a time study from end to start to end. You can sort of take a look at where the results are of that. There's a nice function, start time and end time. It'll go through and show you, after you say create a time study, what it thinks the starting and ending times are. Because if those aren't what you expect, you sometimes get in trouble. So this starts on June 1st at 6 a.m. and ends September 30th at 9 p.m. That seems to be giving you what I would like. You know, that's nice daylight hours. There's another study I decided to run, which is not just from start time to end time, but just from sunrise to sunset. Now, theoretically, those should be pretty darn close to each other because you're not collecting insolation. Well, I guess you collect a little bit at the tail end, the pre-sunset, or pre-sunrise, and a little bit at the tail end of the day. So I'd expect that number to be a little bit bigger. But yeah, the whole issue, you shouldn't be collecting the sun beside that. But it's still pretty much bounded by the same bit. It's just sort of, as opposed to the using the full time, only consider the sunrise and sunset. That might be good, though, because in terms of the number of points it's considering, it's going to consider fewer intervals. And it's only going to consider times where things are going to be valid. There's another one that I plugged in there just to try and make sure things are happening. In this case, I said, go through and take the start time, and then add 120 days to it. Okay, date, add time span. So what that'll do is I can take the start date, add 120 days to it, and that'll give me the end date. Okay, and that's how I ended up over here. If I wanted to be perfectly fair, I'd say 121 days. But we're sort of playing around that. Andrew, do you have anything like in your playing around it that you'd add in terms of anything you've discovered? The time study seems to be a little strange about what it does. Any caveats or any warnings you give people?
Nothing with the thing you're about to cover.
Okay, it all seems to give very similar results, but I think the biggest thing we found is that if you're ever getting zeros, you know, you just go back and kind of look at your time study, and I was just trying it. You'd love to think this would all give similar results, but you know, I think it's off by a little. Okay, so if I went ahead and evaluated it for a project evaluation of our rotation of zero, and I do the first one, actually this time I'm doing the time study over here, it's 525. If I go through and do the sunrise to sunset, you run that.
What does sunrise to sunset mean to start time and end time?
Start time to end time. Oh, say it again. Oh, why does it have start time and end time?
Yeah, you shouldn't know that sunrise is like depending on your location.
That's a really good question. I don't know the answer to that. The question is really, although it has a kind of ending and starting bounding time, the question is if the number of time periods within that. It's like, yeah, I think it's like a list of times where this will have each of the 24 hours and sunrise and sunset will be limited to only the ones that actually have sun in them. but I don't know that for certain. We gotta do some more exploring to figure this out. Because they're just some analyses, but yeah. We know people to ask, so if anyone really wants to dig into that, we can kind of come up with the precise answers. But for the most part, either of these seems to give me fairly similar results. It's around 525,000. Okay, so the question is, that actually worked for one of them. Let's try another individual rotation. Let's say I rotated this thing 45 degrees and ran that. And this is what many of you were doing as you were going through and trying to figure out what the best parameters for your object are. So as I run it 45 degrees, this is now 519. Okay, so it didn't get better, it got a little worse there. So you might say, okay, I like this, but rather than going through and putting in all those values independently, can I just set up a list map and test a whole bunch? Okay. And that's what we want to look at. So to test the whole bunch, you need a list map. And you know how to create a list map. If you want to, you can go ahead and open, I think it's 2A, has the list map sort of all set up, just ready to hook up. Okay, in 2A, all I've really done is I set up a nice little range of rotation values, 0 to 30, going every 10 degrees, equals 0 to 45, whatever you like. So I'm just going to take a range of values. I have my evaluation function, that's looking pretty good, that hasn't changed. But what I'm going to do is disconnect project rotation from the static value. I'm going to leave that open and connect the list into the list map. Same time, I'm going to grab the results list, because the results list will give me the rotations and the installations. So go pop it out in there. I'll say, let's do that. I'm going to disconnect project rotation. I want that to be the hole that will be filled in. And I'm going to grab the results list, because the results list has both of the input values and the average installation values. So you go ahead and run that. So at a high level, that's the final thing you want to be doing in terms of evaluating your forms. If you can go ahead and get the evaluation function, which I should spell properly, if you can get that kind of to work for a single value, then we should be able to kind of feed in a whole list of values and sort of see what's happening. But a good way to test it is to try it with a single value and just see, do you get nulls? What happens along the way? You know, is it somehow casting things wrong on the input side? Yeah, there's all sorts of little weird things break along the way. Okay, now as this is running, let's ask you on your side, even if you didn't do that for the assignment, because you didn't have to do it for the assignment, can you imagine how you would do that for your form? Could you imagine what parameters were you changing, and could you imagine setting up a list map to either go through and just test a single parameter or a series of pairs to test two different parameters? Okay. Excellent, because that's really what it's all about. Okay, so I have, for each of these different values, 0, 10, 20, 30, it looks like I have anywhere from 525, let me zoom on in there, going on down a little bit. As I'm getting towards 30, it's getting a little worse off as I keep on going. The question is, will it come back around somewhere if I ran some more values? Actually, just real quickie is to sort of really, you know, doing it every 30 degrees, even as an evaluation strategy, isn't always so good. Let's try this. Let's go 0 to 360. Actually, 360 minus 45? 315. Thank you. Can't do math in the morning. Okay. If you want to get a real quick sense, don't be afraid to sort of span large, and then after you've sort of evaluated it at a really high level, kind of narrow in on the span that you think is closest. So, you know, going through and evaluating, oh, all 36 variations, if we do it by 10 degrees, probably would take a little bit longer than just going through and evaluating kind of a higher level. See if you get yourself into the right neighborhood, and then sub-evaluate. And that's almost the principle of the genetic algorithm. Sort of do a high level evaluation, get yourself in the right neighborhood, and then sort of increase the fineness. Let's pause as we're in there. Any questions about that? Is that okay? Okay. It all sounds good in principle. It all comes down to the, is my custom node working on? That's where all sort of like that's great problems. Okay. As it's doing this, let me just go ahead and comment. A little bit to kind of give you some more things to think about as we go. We're using this function right now, which is really all about just evaluating the solar installation. There are a lot of other analysis functions we can look at too. For example, if you could picture, not just sort of rotating a surface, let's say you had a little building, some little house or a little building, and you were trying to figure out the right orientation on the site. We can look at it in terms of the solar insulation angle to figure out how we should slope the roof and rotate it around to kind of give them the best solar potential. We could even get really tricky and think about it. Oh, if we get the results back at different times of the day, we could start to say, since my power is worth more in the afternoon, I can sort of bias it and put a little bit of weighting on the average to sort of come up a little bit better to account that time of use. Okay. So solar insulation is good. But we could also go through and look at variations of, for example, we could evaluate the building in terms of its energy performance. So we could go through and compute its EUI. There's another node that's in here that basically runs against Green Building Studio as an analysis tool. And you can basically report for a different set of input values all of the different EUIs and then try either rotating it or changing the height or the width, coming up with different things. It's really sort of an interesting problem. If I said, I want you to go through and come up with a 50,000 square foot building, okay, that has the best EUI, and you can change the rotation, you can change the height, the width, but give me 50,000 square feet anywhere on the site, okay, that's an interesting design problem to think about, and really how you can go through and approach that. Okay. Back over here on the list mapping side, what do we have here? You'll see that anywhere from 525, 516, all the way back up to 518. It looks like at this point, zero is about the best. If I'm sort of oriented around 180, it sort of bottoms out and then it comes back up again. Now, I think that has a lot to do with the fact that my surface just sort of pretty much faces the south. Okay, but if we started flexing the surface now, we could probably come up with an example where it's a little bit better to kind of give a slightly different orientation. Okay, any more, any questions about that, or does that sort of make sense? Excellent. Okay then, let us go ahead and try something a little bit different. Because this is fun with all the evaluation and doing all this type of stuff, but we're gonna keep on going and evaluating different forms. In fact, if you wanna think ahead, that whole notion of the problem that I just described, the 50,000 square foot building, and you could go ahead and sort of change its height or width or rotation or roof slope, any of those parameters, and you're just trying to figure out really the right orientation that sort of maximizes what you want on the site. Okay, think ahead to that as possibility for like the next assignment. Okay, because you're gonna basically take a project like that, and we're going to kind of look at some different evaluation methods or different strategies, and then really try to come up with an optimum that balances two things. So maybe we'll let you know, you'll sort of figure out, oh, if I sort of want to maximize insulation, but I also want to minimize the EUI, some curve of different values and how they trade off. We'll talk about more about that, but Just let me seed your thinking ahead. Okay, beautiful. Let's go ahead, we're gonna shift gears a little bit. I wanna show you just sort of an example that I think is kind of a fun one, that I think it's sort of just very relevant to, you know, you're thinking about doing design work. It's where this whole notion of doing facade design and really how you can use the adaptive components there and do something mathematical. And I wanna share it just because it's sort of, it's a real world example. It's totally related to what we're doing here in class, but you know, it's going to be very applicable to a building that someone's trying to design for the PBL class. Okay, so if you go ahead and open up 4.3, or 14.3, let's just talk about it. Just in general, in the class, there's example, parametric facade, tree facade, or adaptive tree facade. I'm always torn between doing all these sort of very mathematically based things and doing things that look more like real buildings. And you have to sort of strike the balance because the math drives the buildings, but you want it to actually sort of seem a little bit practical too, because it's not just manipulating a lot of math. And here's the idea. Let me kind of rotate this around a little bit and kind of show you the structure. The idea was, what this designer wanted to do was actually come up with, it's almost like a diagrid system or a grid system that would support the outside of a structure. But he had in mind using these tree-like structures because the overall party for how they were thinking about the design was, oh, the building would get sort of heavier towards the top. It would be like a tree where you have a thick trunk and you have thinner and thinner branches and more of them towards the top. So he came up with the idea of using a component that looks like this. And it's kind of a really interesting component. This is a seven-pointed adaptive component. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. And basically, if you want to go through and place this on the side of the building, what you have to do is come up with a scheme for how you can go through and figure out where those 7 points are. Okay, so let's talk about it. There's different ways of trying to approach that. It's really sort of an interesting one. On the one hand, we could go ahead and think of it in sort of a global sense about, you could think about it in a global sense how to compute all those X, Y, Z's, but a lot of problems we work on actually yield themselves better to just think about it always in terms of, self-referentially, how things are relative to you. So at some level, if you could think of a mathematical way of describing, if we can figure out where the bottoms of all the trees are, if we could figure out then how to describe mathematically where the point that's point two right above would be, and then where would points three and four be, okay, relative to that. So rather than kind of thinking about each and every tree and all the points, it's almost this funny issue of can you go through and mathematically always describe differences, you know, from each other to go through and locate the next points and then combine them together. So let me just kind of show the approach to you, and you'll sort of see, I think it's actually kind of a useful one for approaching problems like this. If you open up in Dynamo, let's go ahead and open up, what is it? Let's go to 14.3. And if you can, just go ahead and open up 1A. You'll see we started this as a fairly simple problem. Let me go ahead and even out here. Let me just kind of knock those all out just so we don't look at them right now. Now, ultimately, he's going to want to do this to the facade of a building that, you know, the form is something we'll actually choose. It could be quite a dynamic shape that was formed in Rhino or in Dynamo or any other things. It could be sort of a nice organic shape. You want to wrap that sort of a screen around it. But get started. What I recommend you doing is this. Let's go ahead and see if we can go through and take that form and start by describing it just as a series of curves. So it's all starting up in here. Creating a list of curves. So this is something that actually looks sort of familiar to you. What I'm doing is I have a bunch of X, Y, Z points. My X, Y, Z points are going to be starting at a Z of 0, then a Z of 10, then a Z of 20, then a Z of 30. So there's a bunch of points there. For the radius, I'm going to use a value of 50. I'm just going to use it as a constant radius now, but we can go ahead and change that if we want to and have different radiuses for different functions. Okay. The idea is if you go through and run this,
actually even over here, just to be on the quick side. Let me disconnect the part where we actually go through and place the adaptive components, just so we'll kind of stay in the realm of math for a few minutes here. So if you go through and run this, you should get a bunch of circles back there in the back corner, kind of like the pies. Sort of a very similar sort of thing where I'm just generating four different circles. Based on those circles, which are all at different heights, there we go, there's the Z's, they all have the same radius right now. What I'm doing is grabbing those four different curves and just subdividing them. So let's think about it. In terms of subdividing it, you are used to doing this by now, the idea was at a high level, I had this notion of there being some number of trees. Okay, so how many different tree structures do you want in there? And based on the number that we put in here, we want to subdivide that curve so that it always has enough points to place the trees. Let me pause there for a second, see if that sort of makes sense. Actually, if you want to even sort of see that in action, I guess I've disconnected it right now. Try just, for example, changing that slider. And watch what happens over here to the points, or if you make the slider very dense, watch what happens to the points over there. The idea is just based upon the slider, we're just going to go ahead and place some points over here, which are really going to start to be just the bases of the trees. Okay, so at a high level, I'm just going to go ahead and take based on the number of points, and 17 is certainly a weird number of trees. Go through and say 0 to 1, and basically just compute a parameter which we can place on the curve to subdivide the curve into that many increments. Okay, and that's really pretty familiar to you. So at a high level, we get this list of parameter points, and then we take that over to basically some curves, and we put the points at the parameter. And what we do is on curve 0, we put one of those points. On curve 2, or 1, we put one of those points. And that's how we get the pairs of points on the first two curves. I'll just pause there for a second, see if that sort of makes sense. Even here, if I just did that so far and I took out these other ones, it's going to run that. Are the points still there? Okay, so now all we have hanging around out there in the background is the endpoints. Okay, the idea now is as we go moving up the structure, what we'd like to do is continue to find points sort of relative to those points. So the idea was we have these points, that's the first and the second points on each of the different trees, that's the part that makes the trunk. We want to start defining where point 3, 4, 5, and 6 would be. And if you remember, the structure is a little bit strange. The structure looks like this. We'll say, let's get that example adaptive tree. There's 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We have points 1 and 2 located. What I want to do is this. Is basically go through and figure out where all those other points and think about them mathematically. And it turns out it's actually pretty easy to do. Because if we are always going to have these joining so that your point 7 is my point 6, so the tops of the trees touch each other, okay, we can almost say that really where point 7 is going to just be halfway between the individual point 1s. So if you have a point 1
if you have a 0.1 at 0.20 and you have another one at 0.40, or 7 would be, it'd be 0.30, so it's halfway between the two. And even where 0.4 and 3 are is again very similar, it's just a quarter of the way over. It's either a quarter of the way ahead of it or a quarter of the way behind it. And that's really the logic behind doing something like this, is just really see if you can come up with a mathematical way of describing it. So if I get all the 0.1s, can I say that 0.3 is always wherever the xy 0.1 is, the parameter for it, but a quarter of ahead, 0.6 is a half ahead, you know, 0.4 is a quarter behind, 0.6 is a half behind. Or actually, 0.6 is actually, it's all right on the same thing, it's just up at the highest level. Okay. And that's what the logic does in here. All this logic in here is just basically saying, you're going to go through and come up with all these points. So I got this nice zero, blah, blah, blah. I'll make a nicer sort of array. You'll be easier to spot if I do that. Let me change that to, if instead I have, is it 10 trees or 9 trees? I think it's if I have 9 trees, it will be the easiest for you to read. It's complaining. Oh, I know what it's mad about. It's because my current document is not the Dynamo document. That's the one. Oops, not quite. Maybe it is 10. Okay, this is easy to spot. So the 1 and 2 are going to be at 0.1, 0.2, 0.3. But then as I go through and try to figure out where, for example, 0.6 is, 0.6 is just halfway between. So it's going to be the array. Oh, no, 0.6 is right on top. It's the same. If I say 0.5, pull it over where you can see it. Okay. We're halfway between. And all we really did was we took the point location which was the original point location, and then I just said, let's basically split the distance over to the next tree in half and add it to it. So again, this is one of those things where it's self-referential based on the amount that I should add actually determines, depending on the number of trees, but the place I should add it to is based on the first point that you calculate. So you can sort of think about this thing as you, wherever you sort of generate it, the first point always determines where the subordinate next points are going to be. In this case, points 1 and 2 are really the basis for locating all the other points. So either we're adding plus or minus or we're subtracting plus or minus basically to locate all the other points. But by doing that, we came up with a list of points for 0.3, a list of points for 0.4. So you start to get that it's at 0, 0.25, 0.5. So we're basically computing all those parameters. Okay. When we do go through and compute all those parameters, the idea is we'd like to go ahead and associate with the different curves. So 0.3 gets associated with, I guess, the third curve up. 0.4 gets also associated with the third curve. 0.5 is associated with the fourth curve. So we just put them all together. We basically generate a whole lot of points. Oops. You're right. Thank you. That's not very good at all. There's this thing that happens when you stand up here where your brain turns off. I shouldn't say that. That sounds awful. How about your hand and your brain get disconnected from each other? How about that? Okay, it's good to run that.
I'll run that away. I hopefully have a whole lot of points over here. This is not looking too awfully bad. Here's what I got to do, though. I got all these points that are hanging around. Those are the points for the point one. These are all the points for point two and so forth. That's all looking pretty good. However, I need to get them all together, because what I need to do, although I have a list of points where all the different points I need is kind of scattered through different lists, what I got to do is get all those lists together, so all the points, a list of all the points grouped together. Okay, and the way to do that is very similar to what we did with pairs of points, only it also works with larger lists too. What I'm going to do is do something called list combine. List combine is going to combine a lot of lists. It's basically going to say, okay, you're going to combine all these lists. In which way do you want to do it? And what it's going to do is it's going to combine the first element with one list, or the first element with the other list, or the first element with the third. It's kind of like a list map. It's going to do the second with the second with the second with the second. It's going to do the third with the third with the third with the third. But what should I do to all those? And what I'm going to do is basically just feed those all into a list create. What it's going to do then is basically just put them all in order. So what ListCreate is going to do is the first thing that's going to come out of here is going to be the zeroth item of all these. Second thing that's going to come out is going to be the second thing of all these. So basically take all those lists and interweave them. So what that does as a result is it actually creates something that looks like this. We're now... This is now a collection of, for each of those different points, for the base of each tree, it basically combines the base of the tree with point two for the tree, with point three for the tree, four, five, six, seven. Okay, and puts them into little groups like there. So list combine, a very powerful function. Again, what it's doing, just so you can sort of spot it, is we're taking, for example, let me do this. I'll get the first and the last there so you can sort of see it.
Taking the 50, 0, and the 50, 0 here, what is it? No, and the 47, excuse me, minus 15, and it's basically combining them together. So it's the 50 and the 47. The second one is 40.51, it's 47.553, it's 40.51, it's 47. So it basically combines them together into this.
So super. We have these groups of points together, we can start playing adaptive tree. And if we go through and say, let's take those lists and combine it, and now run it, what you should get
is a nice looking tree structure out there.
Now the cool thing about this tree is at this point, the architect's really not quite sure about how dense those want to be. The designer that I'm talking to is actually a structural designer. He sort of knows he wants to use this as sort of a structural placement way, or like kind of like a dia grid around the outside. So depending upon what the architect comes up with, we can go through and change that. If the architect says that they want 20 trees, we can run that. A very tight pattern. If the architect instead says that she wants to get it all done in only six trees, we can do that.
So we've got some flexibility in terms of doing this. Now, we started by just going through and defining it in this sort of very simple mathematical way, and that's kind of good. We go ahead and just grab these curves over here, but let's talk about getting a little more real, because as you're designing a structure, it may not be a perfect circle. It may be some other interesting curvaceous form, and you want to go through and grab the edges of that other form.
So, just to illustrate that point, over here, let me go ahead and kind of delete these in here. I got another form. Okay, this is also sort of a curvy form. Instead of based on circles, it doesn't have to be based on circles, but it's kind of got a little more interesting shape in terms of what's going on. So the question is, can we apply the same logic to do what we want to? Okay, and the answer is yes. And the way we're gonna do it is actually very straightforward. You got this guy over here. You basically have a whole lot of curves that we use mathematically to define this. If you would rather than working with those curves, you'd like to choose some edges of the form, you can. And how you do that looks like this. You're gonna say basically select an edge. I'm going to grab four of those because I'm actually going to grab four different edges. I got four edges now, and in the same sense that I had a list of curves, I basically need to go through and give myself a list of edges. So I'll say list create. Go to town. So now I'm going to have a list of curves. Okay, we are ready to go selecting some curves. Let's go ahead and select. The order I selected was bottom, middle, kind of intermediate, and top. So if I say starting with the bottom one, select and grab that edge. I'm going to say select, grab the second edge, select, grab the third edge, and select, grab the fourth edge. Okay, I now actually have a nice list over here of, it's null right now, but it's going to be four different curves that are hanging around in there. But let's go ahead and think about where we're going to use this. You might remember over here we had a list of curves or a list of circles, and we fed it over here. We're going to do the same thing here, just using our list of edges instead. So I'm going to break that up and tie that out in here. Excellent. And we'll run this. And you're going to find that that's all it took. Almost all it took to go ahead and get our logic to sort of apply not only from the sort of mathematical thing, but actually to something that looks more like a real structure over here. Now, you might notice it's a little sort of screwed up. Let's talk about what's going on here. See if you can spot what's going on. Yeah, exactly. In a way, it's kind of like, it looks like the first one went to the last one to the first one. This is almost like flipping normals. It's one of those things that sounds, obviously. You have things that are sort of flipped inside out. And for whatever reason, something about the way I drew this, basically the way the points got placed on the curves just in reverse order. Something like that. Not to worry. Okay. If that happens to you, it looks like basically my points 6 and 7 are reversed. What I'm going to do is just come on down here and 4, 6, and 7. Actually, it's probably 5, 6, and 7. Let's try that. I'm just going to go through and reverse them. So what I can do is go through and say list reverse. And let's try just using that instead. I think that I need to do that for all three of those, because they're all the ones in the top row. I could be wrong, at which point we'll go through and fix it. But if you do have a flip, that's the way to fix it. Oh, interesting. Okay, it's not quite reversed. I got something else kind of going on in there. That's its own interesting tree structure in terms of what's going on. I gotta work with the order of these things in terms of figuring out, this one wants to be over here.
Six is in the right place. It's just basically five and six are inverse.
Can you flip five and seven? Does that fix it?
Actually, that's probably true. Let us try just this. Let's go ahead and put 5 to 7 and 7 to 5. Ooh, good suggestion. Okay,
so this is again, pretty simple, but you can start to imagine a much more curvaceous organic structure where we use something like this. Here I'm just placing these components on there. Where I would go if we had more time is I start to say, let's take groups of these points, because we have these points, and think about a panel scheme where we can panelize those and do something, and maybe for each of those panels, we could evaluate them and somehow change them, based on something we want, whether it's insulation or view or something like that, where we start changing the parameters of each of the panels. We could also, if we start getting really tricky, say that, hey, we would like to, on the side of the structure where the sun is shining, have them closer or further apart, and vice versa. We can go ahead and even change the spacing, kind of as we move around the different parts of the structure, and kind of try and figure out formulas to do something like that. But enough of all that for today. Let us adjourn for today and request that go ahead and see if you can get your projects finished up, the whole assignment twos. If there's still little things hanging around the edges, grab me, and we'll try to see if we can solve some of the specific little problems you're having, stuff like that. Get them all wrapped up, today, tomorrow. Just don't want to drag on, stuff like that. We'll give you time to kind of get it right in terms of what you want, which is what you'd like to do. And just as you're thinking ahead, start thinking about that whole issue of if we can go ahead and start thinking about structures and evaluating them across several different criteria that might be competing, what might be an interesting sort of trade-off you'd like to explore for the next assignment. Okay, so if you're all about energy, think about somehow whether you want to play with EUI, if you're all about cost, or you're all about the value of what you're creating, or there's lots of different ways we can evaluate structures. So be thinking about different ways that you might evaluate a building form what I'm looking for are things that are sort of competing in two different directions, that sort of would drive you in two different directions. So we think about the trade-off between those two criteria. Okay? Beauty, let us adjourn for today.